Thank you so much for joining me. I'm reading through the New Testament, doing some limited commentary, and sometimes not so limited commentary as we did in, for example, Romans chapter 9, and also the first two chapters we did quite a bit of commentary. Amen. But we need to define the Bible, amen, as it is written. I do bold, to Jesus be all the glory, first of all, amen. I do bold anything that's not the text that we're reading in Romans 15. So anything that's not bold is the actual text of Romans 15. Anything that I bolded, with the exception of a few I see in the first verse here, there's a mistake. But anyway, anything that's not bolded typically is part of the text, part of Romans 15. I also capitalized some words just to accentuate them because I think they're really, really important. Every word of the Bible is important and God-inspired. Amen? Just to make them stand out. We're doing this to combat the false teaching that's in, I believe, 99% of the churches out there are preaching a false gospel. And we try to prove that now through our reading through the New Testament, at least to start off. I might do the Old Testament too. There's two links down below. I suggest you got to start in chapter 1. Don't start here. We do a little introduction. And we really start defining the book of Romans as we go through. So don't start here, okay? If you happen to come on this video and just found this one, go back to Romans 1. You can do that by going below, clicking the first link on top. It goes right to the New Testament Bible study. And you'll see on the left-hand side, the books of the Bible are hyperlinked. Go to Romans, and it will bring up a web page to my website. And all 16 videos will be on top. And also, all the 16 chapters will be down below, separated. And those are the study notes that you see on the screen here, all right? So let's get started on Romans 15, the New Testament, the Holy Word of God. Romans 15, 1, we, which are true Christians, then that are strong, ought to bear the infirmities of the weak and not to please ourselves. See, it's not your best life now, like all these heretics say on TBN Daystar. If there is a preacher on those stations, TBN Daystar, quote, God TV, Church Channel, all the, anybody that's on TV, they're false. They're wolves. They're heading to hell. Do not listen to them. It's part of a whole false church system that's out there. Amen? So we're not to please ourselves, unlike what they say on those fake shows with those fake, quote, pastors and teachers on the TV. Amen? And that means the entertainments and the excesses of the world. We do not participate in that. Let every one of us please his neighbor, especially the brethren, but in general too. We're not to be rude people, amen, for his good edification. And I'm going to bring in Galatians 6:10 here. As we have therefore opportunity, let us be good to all men, especially unto them that are of the household of faith. Amen. For even Christ pleased not himself, but as it is written, the reproaches of them that reproach thee fell on me. Now listen closely. If you read Isaiah 53, and I pray you know that one really well. Isaiah 53, which we're going to read, is the prophecy of Jesus, how he looked, how he felt, and etc. Okay? It is completely opposite what is preached in the false church system today. Amen? And let's read that, and then I want you to keep in the back of your mind 1 John 2:6. It says, if you say you abide in Jesus, you need to walk as Jesus walked on this earth. You're not going to be Jesus. You're not going to be a little God or a big God or this God or that God. But it says in 1 John 2:6, you must walk as Jesus walked. Let's see what Jesus looked like. Let's see how he was seen by the world. Was he this, you know, cool pastor, this cool Christian, high-fiving everybody? Yeah, what's up? What's up? Or was he a sorrowful person? Was he a hated person? What is he, a despised person? What are you? Are you the talk of the town? Are you still part of the world where James 4:4 says you're an enemy of God if you're a friend of the world? Let's get into scripture. Isaiah 53, verses 2 and 3 we're just going to do here. For he, Jesus, shall grow up as a tender plant and as a root out of the dry ground. He has no form or comeliness. He is not this blasphemous, Catholic, cultish, blue-eyed, long, blasphemous airman. If you have long hair, cut it or you'll end up in hell. He was not this false, quote, small J Jesus that is around on everybody's mantle and altar. Man, Lord have mercy. He has no form or comeliness. He was a Middle Eastern man, by the way, darker skinned. It's amazing to me. And when we shall see him, there shall be no beauty that we should desire him. And I already said he's not part of the wicked Catholic abomination. He is despised. He is rejected of men, a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief. And we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we did not esteem him. That's Jesus. Oh, he's glorious, but he purposely made himself to look below average, a below average man in this world for a reason. But we have all these churches today that have all this hoopla, all the loud music. Blum, blah, 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 blah. I was in it for 6 years. It's blasphemous. Don't go. Blum, blah, 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 blah. And this is rock and roll for Jesus? Contemporary Christian music for Jesus? Heavy metal? For, I mean, this is insane. Rap for Jesus? Are you kidding me? You sing from your heart, a cappella. Amen? And we have a study on that. By the way, you can go on my website and look at music. We have a study on that. Multiple studies on a lot of subjects. Amen? He was despised. He was rejected. He was ugly to the world. Let's get back to Romans 15:4. For whatsoever things were written aforetime were written for our learning, that we through patience and comfort of the scriptures might have hope. We just read a verse from the Old Testament. It's for our learning. Amen? When the apostles walked the earth and they referenced the Bible, they're talking about the Old Testament. Praise the Lord. Now the God of patience and consolation grant you to be like-minded one toward another according to Christ Jesus, that you may with one mind and one mouth glorify God even as the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. One mind and one mouth. You can't be Baptist, you can't be Catholic, you can't be Jehovah's Witness, you can't be Seventh-day Adventist, you can't be Lutheran, Methodist, or anything else. There is one mind, there is one faith, there is one baptism, there is one Christ and one church. Not all those false denominations. I think there's like 40,000 denominations. There is no denominations in Christ. Get out of them. Get out of her, my people. Amen? And they all point back to the Catholic abomination. Denomination, by the way, it comes from the word denominate, which means to divide. Amen? Get rid of your man-made doctrine. Wherefore receive ye one another as Christ also received us to the glory of God. And here we have, starting in verse 8, Christ's the hope of Jew and Gentiles. Amen. Now I say that Jesus Christ was a minister of the circumcision for the truth of God to confirm the promises made unto the fathers. He was born a Jew. He kept all the commandments, and not only of the moral law, which the New Testament, well, which everybody from day one was commanded to keep. Amen. Abraham was justified by his works. His faith was justified by his works of the moral law. But Jesus also kept the Mosaic law, which nobody else has ever done in history. Remember, in the Old Testament, they didn't have the Holy Spirit dwelling in them. Amen? And of course, he's the Messiah. And that the Gentiles might glorify God for his mercy, as it is written, for this cause I will confess to thee among the Gentiles and sing unto his name. Let's look at Psalm 18:49. Beautiful. Therefore, I will give thanks unto thee, O Lord, among the heathen, which means Gentiles of all nations, and sing praises unto thy name. And again, he says, rejoice, ye Gentiles, with his people. And again, praise the Lord, all you Gentiles, and laud him, all ye people. And again, Isaiah saying, there shall be a root, a descendant of Jesse, King David's father, and he shall rise to reign over the Gentiles. In him shall the Gentiles trust. Now the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing that you may abound in hope through the power of the Holy Ghost. And Paul is a minister to the Gentiles, and I myself also am persuaded of you, the believing Gentiles, my brethren, amen, that ye also are full of goodness, filled with knowledge, and able to admonish, able to warn one another. You must warn when you're a Christian, amen. Proverbs says in 27:17, iron sharpens iron, so a man sharpeneth the countenance of his friend, amen. Verse 15 of Romans 15 says, nevertheless, brethren, I have written the more boldly as the instructor of the Gentile brethren unto you in some sort as putting you in mind because of the grace that is given to me of God, that I should be the minister of Jesus Christ to the Gentiles, ministering the gospel of God, that the offering up of the Gentiles might be acceptable, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. I have therefore whereof I may glory through Jesus Christ in those things which pertain to God. For I will not dare to speak of any of those things which Christ hath not wrought in me. We've got to be careful to speak the whole biblical truth. Don't jump ahead of yourself. If you don't have as much wisdom as somebody else that has been in the faith longer than you, don't worry. You'll gain in wisdom, amen, as Jesus wants to reveal it to you. No more, no less. Why? To make the Gentiles obedient by word and deed, to exhort them to obey King Jesus any way at his disposal. Amen. Romans 15:19. Through mighty signs and wonders by the power of the Spirit of God, so that from Jerusalem and round about into Illyricum, I have fully preached the gospel of Christ, Yeah, so I have strived. Strived in the Bible, going back to the Greek, means agonized. I have agonized to preach the gospel. The Bible says, enter ye, strive to enter the straight gate. Agonize, strive to enter the straight gate to heaven. Amen? So he's agonizing to preach the gospel, not where Christ was named, you know, where Paul, where the gospel was not preached before. Lest I should build upon another man's foundation. Paul was particularly called to found churches. Amen? But as it is written, to whom he was not spoken of, they shall see, and they that have not heard shall understand the glorious gospel, of course. Listen, Noah was also a preacher of righteousness. We see the false church today, that's the abundance of churches out there, and they're false. They never preach righteousness or holiness. All they want is your credit card, okay, or your check, or your cash, and they just take two or three verses, and they'll do a 22-minute mixed sermon. They'll mix it in with loud music for 30 minutes, and there you go. They'll put you in a trance. I was there 6 years. It's ridiculous. You need to get out of there. It's a false church, okay? Get into a real holy fellowship. 2 Peter 2, 4, 6 says, if, now listen, oh, Jim, I'm a daily sinner. Oh, I sin in thought, word. That's what my Baptist preacher tells me, my non-denominational preacher tells me, my Pentecostal, my charismatic. No, you know, we're once saved, always saved. And, you know, we're sinners all the time. You know, we just have to believe in God. Oh, listen, listen to who God did not spare. Listen to who sinned. And remember, the angels are a little bit higher than humans. Okay, remember when it said Jesus came in the flesh, he was made a little bit lower than the angels. So he came in the flesh, we're in the flesh, a little bit lower than the angels. Amen? So they have a higher position, so to speak. Amen? So if God did not spare the angels, you Christian out there, that sinned, why are they going to be cast into hell? Because they willfully sinned. But cast them down to hell and deliver them into chains of darkness to be reserved unto judgment. And he did not spare the old world, listen, but saved Noah, the eighth person. Do you know eight people out of millions and millions were saved and the other millions were thrown into the lake of fire, well, into hell and then soon to be the lake of fire? Only eight people were saved that day, people. And the Bible says, as in the days of Noah, so shall be the coming of man. I'm not saying just eight will be saved, but that is a strong statement. And what was he? A preacher of righteousness. He was preaching for 120 years as he was building that ark. And everybody was just ignoring him, saying he's a fool, a Bible thumper, and everything else. Amen? Now what happened? Bringing the flood upon the world of the ungodly, on all the sinners, and turning the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah into ashes, condemned them with an overthrow, making them an example unto those that should live ungodly. Willful sin. Paul finally visits Rome. Amen. Which cause also I have been much hindered from coming to you. Paul was incredibly busy in other areas of the ministry. Although he yearned to go there, he's from there. He yearned to go to Rome. Hey, look at, we got to go on God's timing, not ours. Amen. But now having no more place in these parts and having a great desire these many years to come unto you. He has successfully fulfilled his mission to found churches and appoint elders. He was ready to move on to another place. Amen. And from Miletus, he sent to Ephesus and called the elders of the church. Amen. You see, sets up church, sets up elders, and then moves on. Whensoever I take my journey into Spain, I will come to you. For I trust to see you in my journey and to be brought on my way therewithward by you, if first I be somewhat filled with your company. Ancient Spain was the kingdoms of Spain and Portugal, so his next mission was to preach in as much area as possible, and of course stopping in Rome. Amen. Romans 15:25 says, but now I go unto Jerusalem to minister unto the saints, edifying the saints, as we're going to see below. Amen. For it has pleased them of Macedonia and Achaia to make certain contributions to the poor saints which are at Jerusalem. That's the calling of a Christian, to take care of the least of these, our brethren, to do good to those. Or just read Matthew 25, 33 to 46. Okay, Matthew 25. I didn't put it in here for time's sake, but Matthew 25, 33 to 46, what we do for the least of these. Amen. All faithful saints contribute to those who are blessed. Listen to what it looks like to be a Christian. Does this sound like you? You still live in an opulent house, a house you don't need. By my conscience and reading these Bible verses, I've downsized four times in the last 8 years. Amen? And I got rid of my fancy newer car, and now I drive in a 22-year-old car. Praise the Lord. It gets me from A to B. I love it. Actually, it's my favorite car. Truck actually is a Jeep, and it's a 22 years old. It's a 1998. It's 2020 now. and it's one of my favorite automobiles that I ever owned. And I used to be a very wealthy, monetarily wealthy man. Now I'm rich in Christ now, but I'm not monetarily rich anymore. Beautiful. But listen to what the believers should look like and see if this is you. And remember, 22,000 or so children under the age of 5 years old dies every single day. Every time you take a breath, a child dies of man-made poverty, most likely in their mother's arms or their aunt's arms or whoever's taking care of them. Mother might be dead too, under 5 years old. Okay? All that believed were together and had all things in common. And they sold their possessions and goods, all their non-necessities, and parted them to all men as every one had need. And they, continuing daily in one accord in the temple and breaking bread from house to house, they did eat their meals with gladness and singleness of heart, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to the church daily as such to be saved. Now, does that sound like you? Does that sound like you? Listen closely. It has pleased them verily, and their debtors they are. For if the Gentiles had been made partakers of their spiritual blessings, their duty is also to minister unto them in carnal things, food, shelter, water, basic medicine, etc. I just mentioned 22,000 children. Over almost 10,000 adults die every day from not having, from lack of water, from lack of basic medicine, basically from lack of love. And most all of them in the third world. Don't say, oh, that's over there. The government should take care of it. No, Christian, you need to take care of it. You need to find a way. Christian charity or eternal punishment. Listen very closely. Matthew 25, 41 to 46. This is what happens when you don't take care of the poor as commanded. Then shall he say also unto them on the left hand, depart from me, you cursed, into everlasting fire, prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, you did not give me any food. I was thirsty, you did not give me any drink. I was a stranger, and you did not take me in. I was naked, you did not clothe me. I was sick and in prison, you didn't visit me. And they shall say also unto him, Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or naked or sick or in prison, and did not minister unto you? Then shall he say unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, inasmuch as you did not do it one of the least of these, you did it not unto me. And the consequences is verse 46. And these people shall go away into everlasting punishment, but the righteous unto eternal life. Amen. Romans 15, 28 says, when therefore I have performed this and have sealed or secured to them this fruit, the generosity of the Gentile church, I will come to you by Spain. Once you got the offerings there, he's going to Spain, going to minister to them spiritually and physically. And I am sure that when I come unto you, I shall come to the fullness of the blessing of the gospel of Christ to minister and preach. So he's going to bring earthly stuff to help them live. And he's also going to show them and exhort them more on eternal life. Praise the Lord. Now I beseech you, brethren, for the Lord Jesus Christ's sake and for the love of the Spirit, that you strive together with me in your prayers to God for me, that I may be delivered from them that do not believe in Judea, and that my service which I have for Jerusalem may be accepted of the saints. Remember, the unbelieving Jews absolutely hated Paul. Couldn't figure it out. He was once a hero to the unbelieving Jews. He was killing, putting to death Christians. He was a hero. Now they can't figure it out. Now they hated him. And the Bible says, you shall, Matthew 10, 22 says, Christian, you, if you're a Christian, you shall be hated by all the world for my name's sake. But he that endures till the end of his life shall be saved. Amen. 15, 32 and 33. Let's go. That I may come unto you with joy by the will of God and may with you be refreshed. How wonderful is it to fellowship with true brethren. Got to go far and wide to find them. But they're out there. Now the God of peace be with you all. Amen. So I hope that really edified you. We're going to go on to chapter 16 to finish out the book of Romans. To Jesus be all the glory. If you are walking holy with the Lord, God bless you. And if you're not, I'm praying for you. You can go on my website, and up top it says salvation. Click on that, and that tells you a little bit how to get to the cross. I'm available anytime. My contact is on that website. And you can always reach out to me with a humble heart. In Jesus' mighty name.